All right, well, welcome to our afternoon session here at the DNSSEC workshop at ICANN 54. Thank you for those of you who have been here for the morning sessions and who are here. And thank you again to our sponsors, Affilius, Sierra, Dyne.se, and SIDN for providing us with that lunch. Pretty decent, eh? Lunch wasn't bad today. That's good stuff. So, what are we doing to the screen? The live demos are starting already with messing up the screen.
Make sure the live demos can get to the screen.
Yeah. So I'll keep spinning for 2 to 3 minutes. So I'm Dan York, and I will be the moderator for this session. But we have four different demos and discussions and pieces that are going to be going on. One of those you're already seeing with Wes trying to get his email, his connection working. So we appear to be having a few little details as we go and make sure this all works.
I broke it.
All right. Well, this is the part where we do the more dangerous aspect of the show. Russ and I are having a conversation. We're trying to figure out how long we want to give you folks to Russ's magic clock. So, you know, we're just trying to be careful in that regard.
I'm going to take 15 minutes.
All right, yeah. Why don't you do 15-ish and we'll see how they go. Because Wes is going to mess up getting the connected thing, so.
I need 25.
You need 25? Well, we'll have to see. So without further ado,
15 minutes.
We're going to start up, and we've got until 2:30 that we're going to be going with this. So we have an hour and a bit that we'll have time for this. We will do each of the demos, and then we'll have time for questions right after each one. So that's why we said the 15 minutes, we include a little bit of time for some questions as well, because they are four different topics. And I'm told we're having some live demos here too, right, guys? Or something? Maybe? Sarah says no. Well, we might. We've got to have these dangerous things. All right, so without further ado, I will give you one of the IETF 93 hackathon participants, Sarah Dickinson, to talk about DNSSEC and legacy applications.
Thank you very much. So what I'm going to talk about in this presentation is a proof of concept implementation that aimed to provide DNSSEC for legacy applications. Now I'm presenting, and I was involved in this project, but unfortunately the people that did the real work behind it weren't able to be here today. So I'm presenting on their behalf, and those people are Alison Mankin and Gary Visvasvarian from VeriSign Labs, Siajan Bakuti, who's a student at the University of North Texas and did a summer internship at VeriSign Labs, and also Willem Turup from NLNet Labs. Next slide, please. So the goal of this work was really to look at how to enable end-user applications to benefit from the security that's provided by DNSSEC, but not just to stop there, but to also think about how you can offer access to newer features in the DNS, such as privacy. Next slide, please. So some background. The initial scope of the project was to look at Linux and Unix systems, where there's a default DNS.Rodolfo library. And applications typically do name resolution via the getAddressInfo and getNameInfo methods. The majority of applications on those systems use that default resolver. There are a few, some browsers in particular use their own, but that's not that common. One of the big issues, though, is that the current library implementations don't support DNSSEC, nor some of the other more modern DNS capabilities. Next slide, please. So there are ways to work around that. One is you can use a validating recursive, but that last mile issue isn't really solved at the moment. Also, that wouldn't enable access to newer features such as privacy. Now, of course, there are several libraries available that do support DNSSEC. The one I'll mention here is GetDNS, which is fully featured in regards to DNSSEC, and it also has support for TLS. But the downside is, if you want to make use of those new libraries, you have to make code changes in the applications. Next slide, please. So we look more at how the default name resolution service is provided, and it's available through the name service switch. And this is a pluggable interface which allows different system services to integrate into the operating system. And administrators can configure specifically which services they want to provide the information to the runtime libraries here. Very typically, it's where you get user information and also DNS name resolution services. So if you've taken a look at this, you'll see that this is configured in the etc.nsswitch.conf file. And in particular, DNS service there, very typically, the default configuration is that you look up in files first, normally etc. hosts, and then do DNS resolution. Next slide, please. So the solution that's proposed in this work is to provide a new NSS service that uses GetDNS to access the new features that we're looking for. And by doing this, it should be transparent to applications so that any application using the standard API can seamlessly get support for DNSSEC through this mechanism. Next slide, please. So this is a picture of the architecture that was implemented in the proof of concept. So applications will continue to use the name resolution interface as they do today. Underneath that, NS switch is managing what's actually offered, and instead of using the default libresolve, a custom module has been implemented that uses GetDNS but implements exactly the same API, and that's a drop-in replacement then for libresolve. GetDNS in this scenario works as a fully validating stub. I'll mention in passing that the proof of concept work also experimented with an LD preload mechanism, but I won't go into details of that in this presentation. Next slide, please. So in terms of configuring this, it's very straightforward. To enable it, it's simply a question of editing the nsswitch.conf file and changing the hosts line, replacing DNS with GetDNS, and that's all that's involved. Now, the configuration for this is managed in a separate file, and in the proof of concept, it was in etc.getdns.conf. And the default option that's offered is DNSSEC validate. There is also another stricter mode, which is DNSSEC secure only, which could be considered for use. So this is a very lightweight configuration, and this one of the other aims of the project is that it wanted to be possible to deploy and configure this via automated tools like Ansible and Puppet. Next slide, please. Something else that was investigated in the proof of concept was whether or not it made sense to try and offer end users the ability to do their own configuration. So are end users smart enough to understand DNSSEC yet? Discuss. So what they did look at doing was offering via a web page the ability to make the settings stricter than the system ones. So I'm sure this might get some discussion. Next slide, please. One of the bigger issues with this work was the signaling mechanism. So the standard library calls, they have an existing interface and standard error messages. And what that means is, in the case of DNSSEC, it's hard to signal to the application that what you've received is an answer, but that it perhaps has an invalid signature. So you can signal failure, but that's indistinguishable from many of the other causes of a serve fail. So what you would really like is a way to be able to signal the user, I did get an answer, it's not that the network's down, I got an answer, but it was insecure. Next slide, please. So the initial work done in the proof of concept on this was to look at, for those applications that can consume HTTP, was to use a redirect page that could actually inform the user this site's bogus or this site was insecure. Now, this approach is quite simplistic and it only works for certain scenarios, but the idea was it was a proof of concept to show that you could provide that information to the user. So what's being looked at in the ongoing work is other mechanisms for doing the signaling, so browser plugins or system tray notifications. Next slide, please. So that's top of the list on the future work. Other things that are being considered are looking at adding a system cache to the validating stub to improve performance. Also offering configuration options related to TLS, and this work is almost working, but not quite. And the idea here is that you could choose to do, for example, disable TLS, prefer it, or require it. Also, want to take a look at how you might make that configuration policy more fine-grained, because it's quite coarse at the moment. Another topic is looking at advanced security, so putting this on SE Linux, AppArmor, how would it work, containers, etc. And as I said, this is limited to Linux and Unix systems, so a slightly different mechanism will be needed to get support for this on Windows and on Mac OS X. Next slide, please. So the intention of this project is to release this module open source. Currently the wheels are still turning on getting that rubber stamp, so unfortunately I don't have a repository that I can point you at. But if you're interested in this code, please grab me right after this session and we can talk. Also, obviously, to make this viable, there needs to be work done with various platform communities in order to get this open source module embedded so that this is available out of the box on all systems. Next slide, please. So, in summary, what we've proposed here is a solution that enables DNSSEC validation for legacy applications, and that was done through the existing name resolution framework for Unix and Linux systems and BSD. So it's integrated into the operating system via NSS switch. The design here uses the getDNS library under the hood to handle all the DNSSEC related functions. I don't have a demo to do today, but I do have one on my laptop. So again, if anybody's interested, please approach me after the session and I can show you how it works in practice. Next slide, please. And that's all my slides. Thank you for your time. If you do have comments or questions, please direct them at that mailing list, because that's where all the work on this has gone on. And I'd be happy to take any questions now. Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah. Are there any questions for Sarah about what she did here? Yes, Christian, go ahead. And for folks in the audience, there is a where you see the gentleman going to the portable mic. Please do go over there. Go ahead, Christian.
Thank you. I'm Christian Hesselman. I'm with .NL. My question is, this works for Linux machines and Ubuntu and that sort of thing. How would you be able to get this kind of libraries to more popular operating systems such as Apple and Windows and that sort of thing?
So they don't use that same NSS mechanism, but they have analogs of it. So the hope is that we'll be able to find a way in to leverage it, but through a similar shared library. That's the hope.
Because you would somehow need to liaise with Apple or with the folks in Retmon to actually get this into their operating system.
If it were to be embedded, yes, you're right. But hopefully if it gets a foothold on the other systems, then that can be a driver for that to happen. But yeah, it's a challenge.
Gentlemen, the mic in. Yeah. Please do state your name.
Mark Solé, Global Village, Registrar. Do you consider also adding privacy considerations into that library? Because the immediate use scenario that comes to mind is using it in our data center on our centralized resolvers. On individual servers. So we would also cover the last mile. But what also would be very interesting if privacy considerations could be taken into account, because that's the other DNS deficiency that we are currently thinking about.
So you're talking about encrypting the channel that the DNS queries go over?
Yes, and sending minimal queries, stuff like that.
So GetDNS already supports DNS over TLS, and that's work in progress on the current module. So that can be supported through this. And GetDNS also...
And that is in experimental status, or...?
So in GetDNS as a standalone library, TLS is fully functional. All that's left to do is actually implement it in the module via configuration options. So it will be available.
Thank you.
Any other questions for Sarah? I think it's intriguing work. I look forward to seeing what you are able to do with this. Well, then please join me in a round of applause and thanking Sarah. Next up in our list, although I don't know if they, are you up, Wes?
We're ready.
You're ready? All right. Next, I will turn it to Wes Hardiger from Parsons to show us something here. Dane secured email demonstration.
Well, so we'll talk about the demo part. So I'm going to ask later on if you guys actually want to see the demo, because it's going to be very small and everybody ought to, you know, walk forward. But we'll get through some slides first and we'll see what you guys want to do. So I'm Wes Hardiker, and I'm going to talk about Dane and an email in particular and how to secure mail, really the only way to really secure mail. So I'm going to talk about a little bit about my background. I'm going to talk about what's in scope, because one of the things I hate about doing demos is that I don't get to give you instruction and explanation about stuff, because I'm going to show you more live stuff. And so I'm not going to talk incredible detail about background. And then I'm going to talk about what it takes to secure email and how to implement those requirements. So first off, a little bit about me. I'm part of a network security research group at Parsons, and we are an expert on all things, you know, underground layer security stuff that most people don't have to think about, including DNS and Dane and email and things like that. My DNS history, I've done a lot in the past. There's five DNS RFCs, and I'm pointing the last two out in particular because they came out last week. 7671 and 7672 are Dane operational guidance as well as Dane over SMTP. It's only a week old out the door. I'm also the founder of the DNSSEC Tools Project, where we have lots of interesting utilities, and DNS Sentinel, which is our monitoring service that makes sure that your DNS is operating the way you expect it to. So what I am covering today is how to set up secure email with Dane. Operationally, how do you set it up? What I'm not talking about is how it works, because I've done that before. In fact, I did that last time. So you can look at the slides from Buenos Aires, where I dive into detail about how it works. And I also have a YouTube tutorial that's about an hour long about Dane and SMTP, as well as some other protocols as well, that was recorded in Chile last year. And then also, I'm not talking about securing email clients to their ISP. I'm not talking about POP and IMAP and delivering mail from your email client. I'm talking about, go to the next one, the server-to-server work. So mail, you don't send mail directly to your destination. You send mail to your ISP, and your ISP figures out where to go next. That is unlike chat protocols and other stuff that may talk directly to the end person. Mail doesn't. It goes to your ISP first. So in that diagram, it's that middle part between the two boxes, not Alice on the left or Bob on the right. So first off, let's talk about what it takes to receive secure mail. How do you tell the world, I have a mail server that can do secure TLS as opposed to just accepting anything out in the open? So it takes a few things. First off, you have to be able to be found by the distant server that wants to talk to you. And that involves DNS and DNSSEC to make sure that they get to the right place, as opposed to spoofed DNS and things like that can get you to the wrong place. And you also have to tell them, hey, I can accept an authenticated connection and an encrypted connection. And that's where Dane comes in. Dane is what signals that and is what points to the right keying material so that you know that you got to the right place. So the end result is your DNS zone must be DNSSEC signed, and your DNS zone must include a Dane record for your SMTP servers. It gets a little more complex if you dive into outsourcing your DNS and things like that, but it all works. Or outsourcing your mail. So this is where the font starts getting smaller, and I wonder if I can read it. So receiving secure mail with PostFix, and you can download these slides too, but the first thing you have to do is create a certificate. Every TLS connection requires that you have a certificate. So you, that's the OpenSSL line to very quickly create a X509 certificate. It does not need to be CA signed. That's one interesting thing about DANE and SMTP is that actually the CA industry doesn't need to be invoked. You can use it. There are ways of doing that too. My talk in Chile talks all about that, about which method you might want to pick. This one is a straight TLS certificate without sending it to a CA first. And then the last three lines tell PostFix how to use it. There's only three configuration lines. You have to point it where the key file is. You have to point it where the certificate file is. In this case, they're the same because they're encoded in the same file. And you have to tell that you want to possibly accept TLS connections. So you can say TLS security level equals may. In other words, people may talk to you with TLS. You may talk outbound to TLS. It's not required, though. It's opportunistic, TLS. In other words, opportunistic means you make advantage of it when you can. If you can't, you fall back to none. So in my demonstration today, I set up a couple of test records. Font's getting smaller still. In the dnssectools.org zone, I created dane.dnssectools.org. And in it, I put a DANE record that included an MX record pointing to a server. And for that server, I put in a TLSA record. Paul, a little bit later, is going to talk about how to create the TLSA record, so I'm not going to duplicate that here. But he'll talk about how to actually produce that later. And then I signed the zone. Obviously, you have to have a signed zone. So the combination of signing the zone and signing the TLSA record means that everything is secure, and that TLSA record points to my certificate that I just created. So it's critical when you are managing this system that you, every time your mail server certificate changes, you must update that TLSA record. If they don't match, you'll stop getting mail. Okay, so I'm going to repeat that because it's important. If you do this, if you set up secure mail, make sure that your DNS infrastructure and your email administrators talk to each other. They have to, every time that certificate changes, you must update your DNS to go along with it. There's a really cool website, which I can demonstrate again in a minute if we decide to do the demo, which is dane.sys4.de. It is a fantastic testing utility. You plug in any email, any host name that you want, and it'll test to see if it can securely send you email. And it'll tell you what's wrong if you can't. So the instant you actually put something out for a TLSA record and for TLS and for DNSSEC, it'll walk and make sure that all of those things are operating properly, and it'll tell you if it's not. So that's how you receive it, right? So you can, so you set up those things. You note that I didn't install very special, I'm using PostFix in this example. Later in my slide deck, if you want to download them, there's a couple of other utilities that you can use. EXIM is another mail server that you can use. But I didn't actually have to configure very much. There was only three lines, and all I had to do was basically install a certificate. People will find it if they use DANE, and they'll get to you. So now I'm going to talk about, well, how do you do it on the outbound side? How do you send up your ISP to send mail securely to somebody else? And you do that by making sure that your DNS software verifies DNSSEC records. In other words, is it a validating resolver? And every lookup from start to finish, if you're going to do DANE and SMTP, has to be validated start to finish for that TLS to be authenticated in the long run. So you have to have your MX records and your address records and your DNSSEC signatures and all that kind of stuff that we've talked about endlessly here at ICANN for years has to be done. And then the mail server software has to be able to validate those DANE records. It has to be able to know how to talk to a DNSSEC compliant name server or do validation itself. In the case of PostFix, it's talking to a DNSSEC compliant name server. And this, and the certificates have to match, obviously, too. The DANE record has to match the server's TLS certificate that is offered. So, when to configure PostFix, it's actually, again, quite simple. The PostFix team and Victor Duchovny, who's done a lot of the code, did a very good job making it very simple to deploy. But you need a DNSSEC validating resolver. You need PostFix 2.11 or better, or some of the other ones, but PostFix is the first out the door and it's the one I'm familiar with, so that's what you're going to see here today. And they have to be running on the same host. This is the way the Postfix team decided not to do validation in the application. They wanted to make sure that they send the request somewhere secure, so it should only be running on the same host. They expect the local validating resolver to be running on the same host. And then you need some configuration, and there's really only two lines. There's a couple more optional ones, but you set the Dane, the SMTP TLS security level to Dane. That says, basically, you want to use TLS if you can get there via Dane. It's still a May. If there is no Dane record, it will not deliver mail. It'll still deliver it unencrypted if it can not find a Dane record. And then you set the DNS support level to DNSSEC, saying you need that AD bit turned on to your local validator. So I'm actually going to go on. So we'll do the demonstration in a second if you guys want to see it. You might have to crowd around the screen because the font's smaller. But basically, I have a couple of demonstrations. Go ahead and go on to the next one. I have one under dane.dnssectools.org. I said I created up a record, and the demonstration has my local laptop mailing to itself, and my laptop is running a Dane-compliant version of Postfix, and it's able to go out and talk to the remote server, look, do the DNS lookups, and then show that, you know, it's getting there successfully. Next. I also created another one that created that adds the TLSA record, which is actually the same thing. We'll actually skip. We'll only do that one. And then I created a bad one, too. So there are red marks up there that you can't read from the back. I created a TLSA record with a bad entry. And so I can actually show you that, you know, if you send mail to that bad address, it will get queued. And it will not resolve until it'll go through the standard, you know, wait 7 days or whatever you have your mail agent, because it refuse to deliver it if you've set up Dane and it doesn't match. So in this case, I messed with the fingerprint, so it doesn't match. Yes. And then the final one is I created another set of records called Dane-Bad2, where there's one server that with a good record and one server with a bad record, and the MX records prioritize the bad one first. So you can watch it. These are tests that you can do at home. And if you write me, I'd be happy to give you the configuration. So you can watch it fall back. It'll try and talk to the first MX, and because the certificate doesn't match, you went to the bad guy. You went to the wrong place, or you went to the operator that failed to configure things properly. And it falls back to the second one. That's really kind of cool to watch. And it says, you know, bad certificate found, and then it'll fall back to the next one and still deliver the mail. So I do recommend you guys come out and play. There's actually, remember, the RFC got produced last week. Last week, there's 28,000 domains with Dane active TLSA records. And granted, some of the reasons those numbers are so large is there's a couple of ISPs doing this for every domain that they serve. In Germany in particular, there's a whole lot of German domains ending in .de that are signed Dane records. So the ramp is just huge. There's a lot of people turning this on. A lot of them are small domains, but some of them are big. About 10% of them are bigger. Next. So first off, any questions? I'd be happy to throw out the demo. We're actually running short on time, too. But I don't think you guys can read it. So my suggestion is that if you want to see it, I'd be happy to show it to you later. Because it's very small text in the log files that say, yes, I did validate. I have some TCP dump, you know, files that I can show you to show that it actually, you know, turned on encryption and things like that. Any questions at all?
Questions? Go ahead, Roland.
It's an interesting talk. Thank you. I was wondering, do any of the big email providers, like folks like Google or Microsoft or whatever? Presumably they support TLS on their mail servers. Have you talked to any of these folks to see if they would be willing to supply pointers to their customers if you put this record in your DNS zone? Because, for instance, I have a toy domain that I run on your stuff, but I operate the DNS for that, obviously.
Right.
So all I'd have to do is stick the right record in my zone and I'd be done, right?
You can do that, but do watch out that if they roll their X509 certificate, that you would have to notice it, because otherwise you'll have this period where the DNS record, keep the TTL short, notice it as fast as you can. Paul, you want to answer?
Actually, I think you're wrong, because you have to have the MX target signed, which would be the Google domain, so having your own domain signed doesn't actually matter.
If the target is in Google, that's true, yes. Which is the reason, by the way, that Dane is Dane and DNSSEC are the only way to secure your mail, because if you have an MX record to evilhacker.com, and even though evilhacker.com might be signed, you can redirect people anywhere you want. So you have to have secure from, you know, from the root on down all the way through the MX chain to you in order to secure your mail. Yep.
The guys from sys4.de are actively working with ISPs in Germany to get this rolled out.
Yeah, so that's Victor Duchovny. He wrote that website that lets you test your zone. It's a fantastic system. He's the one that he has reached out to a lot of people to answer your original question. Microsoft and Google and theirs, no, they don't have Dane records in place yet. There are some other pretty big ones. If you look at the slides from Buenos Aires, which is where that picture was taken, I do have a list like 3BSD Foundation and things like that. There are some fairly big names out there that have TLSA records in place. The IETF it switched. I think it still does. The IETF is actually Dane compliant now. ICANN is coming. I talked to somebody about that this week. It's really, really close.
Well, gentlemen on the mic. Okay.
Mark Sway, Global Village, newcomer to Dane. Actually, I have a question about the certificate. When I have to change the certificate, do I need a rollover process, like with the KSA?
Good question. Yes. So you would need to put in two TLSA records. So you put in the new TLSA record to match your new certificate. Wait for it to be distributed. So wait for the TTL, usually times twice. And then you can swap your new certificate in, and then another two TTLs later you can pull out the old.
So I can have two TLSA records.
And yes, you can.
It looks for either that matches.
Exactly.
Okay, thank you.
Yep. Good question,
Rick.
I'm not going to speak for them, but at a couple various anti-phishing kind of meetings, I mean, I understand that those big players are interested. It's on their map.
There's a number of secure email technologies that all play well together, that if you have them all, you'll be better off. And that includes, DKIM and SPF and DMARC and Dane. If you do all of these, we are beginning to lock down the world into a better place, but it's a step-by-step kind of process. Okay.
Any other questions for Wes?
Abdulmanan Galila, fellowship newcomer. First time to be here.
Welcome.
thank you. Slide number 14, you said that you must run on the same host. For IDN domain names or for host names, it is not logical for me to use XN blah, 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 blah in the host name of the server. So I have made a workaround that I made virtual box that have the IDN domain name and it works well.
Well, so the reason that it needs to run on the same server has nothing to do with the domain name in question. It has to do with postfix is not doing validation of DNSSEC records. So if you had, say, in your resolve.conf file, if you were sending all your DNS requests to Google's 8.8.8.8, right, you'd be sending that request out and you're trusting the AD bit back. You're doing no cryptography to make sure that Dane record that you're getting back has been verified. You're trusting the network between you and Google's, in this case, in my example. But so by having it on the same host, you know that all of the validation is being performed on the same machine that's using it. It's just a security measure. It has nothing to do with IDN or other related stuff.
There is another question. What is the difference between Dane and BGP?
Dane and BGP?
BGP.
PGP is designed to secure person to person. So it is intended to, most of the time, secure somebody's individual email, whereas Dane is designed to secure the transport between two SMTP servers. So very different security models. That's another good email security technology I didn't mention a second ago, which is getting down to the object level, signing the message, as opposed to signing just the secure transport between the mail carriers. Does that make sense?
Are you going to talk about that, Paul? Okay. Well, so we may have somebody else who could talk about how DNSSEC and Dane can deal with PGP as part of this coming up soon. But any other questions for Wes? Yes, behind the gentleman behind. Could you go to the mic or have Wes repeat it? Either way. or use one of the mics up here. There are a couple more seats up here if anybody wants to come and sit and join us. You too can have a mic.
Thank you very much. Is this method working with all version of the SMTP, advanced SMTP, secure SMTP?
So the SMTP protocol has quite a while ago specified how to send SMTP over TLS. It's been around for a very, very long time, very long time in computer speak, which is, you know, not that long. So it's old enough that that almost every mail server out there supports it, including, you know, SendMail and other stuff too, which you know, even hasn't been updated that recently. SendMail doesn't support Dane yet, but so yes, it is a way of securing that to make sure that you're getting to the right place. So it's making sure that when you open your TLS connection, you're getting to the right place. If you go watch my video on YouTube, if you pull the link out of the slides later, I talk about that more specifically of
how okay, it need to open the cryptography because when you're using advanced SMTP, it has to open the packet and bring it header and then check it with PTR record, as I know.
Dane doesn't work. Dane uses the Start TLS protocol, so when you open a new SMTP connection, the remote server says I can handle all these options in SMTP. One of them is Start TLS, and if both sides support that, then they say, okay, I'm going to start TLS. What happens after that is on the client SMTP server, it is making sure that the certificate the other side gives you matches what's in the DNS. So that's all that Dane does.
Another question is it working with e-boxes? In some countries, there are local emails. They use some e-boxes, and there are so many servers, and there are they don't use SMTP, they use a special protocol to use only local email with each other for all the hometowns.
Yeah, so Dane
only
works.
Do you have any experience about?
I don't. Dane only works with SMTP, so that's all it's designed to work with.
Thank you.
Thank you for your questions, and let's join around in thanking Wes for his work here. I would also just like to say, I think the work that Wes and Victor Ciccone have been doing has been great, because I find it somewhat ironic that Dane, which is this protocol that we have now for putting TLS certificates into this, would find one of its best use cases in dear old email, you know, this underappreciated, and anyway, yeah, it's great to see that the work is going on there. I would encourage you to go look at that site that Wes mentioned about the sys4.de site that Victor set up. It's a good test site for email components around that. We also should be clear, Dane is a protocol, is a mechanism, RFC 6698, for storing TLS certificates or pieces in there in DNS and being used in this way. It's the TLSA record and the other pieces. So to the gentleman who was just up there at the microphone, you know, asking about that, you know, Dane can be used for lots of different protocols and different things. It happens that Wes is focused, the technology he's working on is focused on using it for SMTP. Somebody else could choose to use it for another email protocol or anything like that. So the ones you were talking about from those proprietary boxes, they could choose to use it if they wanted to, if somebody wanted to go and implement it.
Yeah, I misspoke a few minutes when I said minutes ago that Dane was only designed to use with SMTP. That's Dane is a protocol just for putting out X509 certificates. And again, my YouTube talks actually talks about Jabber and all sorts of other stuff.
Right, yeah, and we've seen a lot of uptake in this in the Jabber community and the work they've done in some of the voice over IP protocols. It just happens that at this particular session, we have most of our panelists talking about email in some way, which brings me to the next one, giving a different look, which is you, Rick, according to, you guys can flip if you want to, but whatever. Paul's got a bad last and clean up all the issues that we've slowly been assigning to Paul. But Rick Lamb is going to talk about a different email technology.
I'm going to talk about the end-to-end thing, S-MIME.
being able to encrypt your email end to end, and this way, if you're like me and you know don't trust your cloud provider or are a terrorist wanting to contact another terrorist, this is perfect for you. Okay. All right. So I'm going to have some difficulty here, probably getting everyone to see this. As you see, my slides are going to be really, really simple. I want to leave as much time for the demo, so I'm not going to try to make it look pretty or do anything. Okay, that's the name of the talk. That's me. This is stuff that I've done mostly on my own time, if not all on my own time, really. Okay, so Microsoft Outlook is still a very popular client, okay? And every time I come to these meetings, I feel like, you know, if I say Microsoft or I say proprietary software, I'm basically shunned from the community, shunned from that particular conversation, or even worse, have beer poured on me. So I've had, you know, so, but it's a popular email client, and I don't care. I just want DNSSEC to get used. I mean, it's a platform for everything else, just like Windows is a platform for something. Last program I wrote, I don't care. I wrote my own memory allocator, my own stack switcher, I don't care. I ran it under Windows, who cares, right? It's like DOS. So, and there's a history of S/MIME support. And it's been around for a long time, okay? Which is, just is, it's there. It's in Outlook, it's in so many other packages. I'm trying to get some estimate right now, the Outlook usage, 80%, something like that out there, you know, for desktops, mostly because of large corporations. So, you know, Dan Kaminsky recognized this back in 2009, okay? So I can't take credit for this. I mean, you know, people in the IETF are now working on it very heavily. But, you know, Dan demoed this back in 2009, you know, at a DEF CON. You know, he did a real hack, you know, basically a hack that the gamers use to cheat games so that they win, you know, basically intercepting DLL calls and stuff. Not really a product, okay? But I haven't seen anything happen since 2009. I mean, and with my Microsoft hat, and I've even, you know, attempted to try to fund some efforts to say, we got enough Unix geeks here. I want a Windows programmer. I want something that runs natively on Windows, you know, that fits their model, that hopefully they would find pretty enough that they would at some point just say, well, just make it part of Windows. Bingo, we win. DNSSEC is then, you know, DNSSEC would be everywhere then. So secure global distribution, you can read this, S/MIME certs, you know, has always sounded like the killer app for DNSSEC, okay? I mean, it's one of the biggest problems out there. We're seeing a lot of traction, what Wes was talking about, between servers, and I think that's wonderful. It's really wonderful. But as far as being able to do true end-to-end encryption of email, where the only way someone was going to get your email was going to be a court order on your laptop. So why hasn't anyone done this? Done a Windows version? Well, I talked about this. We don't like Microsoft. Maybe they don't like me now, but you know, it's an unfamiliar world to us. We've all grown, you know, cut our teeth, and you know, in the Linux community, in the Linux world, not many of us. I'm certainly not going to say, oh, I know there are people that know this stuff. Crypto API, Outlook plugins, completion port IO. Turns out, you know, Windows is actually a very fast operating system. It was, you know, written by somebody, you know, that used to be in the DEC world and is patterned somewhat on VMS, if any of you guys are old enough. And that was a wicked fast transaction as a processing system. So if you can get at the base of Windows, you actually have a good platform to develop on. Okay. A lot of projects we do are great. They're, you know, they're open source and they're wonderful. Some of them have a lot of support. But whatever the product is, it's got to be something that's supported. I believe in order to get DNSSEC widely deployed, there needs to be something there that people can just click install and there's support. Okay. With support comes cost, because this would not be a free thing. Okay. So you can guess where I'm heading with this. This is, you know, I want a for-profit company to see this as a killer app and actually spend some time on it. So maybe the problem is there's no motivation. There's one large organization I know in the US. They all have little tags when they walk around Washington, D.C., and some of them have maybe, you know, little insignia on their lapels. At least 3 million users have this and are forced to use S/MIME. I have not in the military, but I've worked in Washington, D.C. before and been part of one of these agencies where And this is many years ago. We were all taught to use SMI. I mean, use this, and we have credentials. We have a, everything is there. But we still can't easily exchange encrypted email or secured email from others, because how do you distribute the certificates? Okay, so I'm just going to start the demo here. I should say, I don't see it in there, but I mean, you know, we all know there is a couple drafts in the IATF. One is exactly on this, SMIME-A. It's done by Paul Hoffman and Jacob Schlieder, and it's still, I think, in draft state. However, you know, this is we all, us geeks all recognize that this is something we want to do. So I'm going to run through a demo here. The demo guides will probably not be nice to me, but I'm going to still do this. I have a backup movie version of this if this doesn't work. Here we go. Okay, so I have two machines here. I have a one Windows machine here. I have another Windows machine here, both all running in VMs under Linux. Okay, well, here we go. I mean, you can see what's up there. I'm going to first create an email account and set it up in Outlook, and this is all ugly stuff. So, you know, I have other businesses and companies that do this sort of thing. So, you know, I have something that generates an email account. So I got to pick, and I'm doing this because I'm proving to you this is not a rigged demo. Okay, I'm just looking here. I see Bosch. I got to pick something random. So let's create an email account, Bosch. I know you can't see that. I'm just saying, I'm creating an email account of Bosch at dnssec.info. Okay, and I don't know, FooBar 2. It's a promo code. The Daughter River is over there. Okay, so I'll create that. Okay. Okay, there we go. All right, so it comes back, and God, I wish I could make this thing. How do I make this bigger? I can't. Okay, anyway, account information comes back. Account's been created. I even created a, sorry, let me put this in the middle here. I've even created a, I don't know if you see over in the blue there, I've created a link to a, a PKCS 12 package with certificates and everything in it. Okay. That was the first step, create an email account. Now set it up in Outlook. Okay, that's easy. So I go to Outlook. And I know you guys hate Outlook. This is something, you know, something you guys don't normally like. But all right, so I'll create one. I'm going to do manual setup. And I need to do this because I need to get a certificate from Start SSL or something like that. All right, so my name is Bosch. Bosch. Okay. Bosch at dnssec.info. IMAP, incoming servers are going to be mail.dnssec. That was all on the other page, dnssec.org. The other one is outgoing, mail.dnssec.org. Okay, password is barf, something called barfu2. Okay. I want to encrypt my outgoing stuff, of course, SSL, TLS, 8587, I think is that port number. Okay, hopefully I've typed all that right. Let's see if I can create an email account. Next. Ooh, didn't like that. Okay, so bar 2, let's see. Screwed this up. Let's see. Okay. Was it FooBar? Oh, FooBar 2. Let's try that. Oh, I hate when that kind of thing happens. Okay. Yeah. Start over. If this gets too weird, I'll just. Okay, if this gets too weird, I'll just go to the movie demo or make add a shortcut version of this thing. All right, so let's create another email account. Let's see, I don't know, Bosch2 at dnssec.info, bar foo2, create. There, okay, let's kick off Outlook. Okay. All right, let's create a new account. Okay.
out. Let's see. Bosch 2. Bosch 2 at the nsec.info. Okay. Mail.dnsset.info. Oh, that's org. Right. Org. Mail.dnsset.org. Okay. Password is bar32. Okay. Settings outgoing encrypted. Okay. My fingers. Anyone know any good jokes? Let's see. If this is kind of the rate that this is going, oh no, there it goes, it's testing. Check. Now it's testing to see if it can send. There, finished. Okay, so it worked. Tested both outgoing and incoming. Finished. Okay, so now I have an account there, Bosch 2. All right, there it is. All right, so I got an account. I need to now get an SSL certificate for that account. Okay, so fine. Go to start SSL. Everyone knows these guys will give you free certificates. Let's see, there you go. Pick one. Everyone's heard of start SSL, right? I mean, they're one of the few people that will give you actually a free certificate, SMIME or for a server. Email address set validation. Again, I'm playing ball here. I'm not doing any stupid certificate tricks. I'm trusting the CA system here, so. Bosch2@dnssec.info. Okay, fine. It's going to send me an email. That's why I create the email account first. Okay. So, again, you know, to me, if this demo finishes, the goal here is to show that there, you know, with a very simple, small plugin, I'm not going to call it a plugin, a piece of software. That translates between LDAP and DNSSEC, not the other way around. We talk often about trying to put various pieces of data in the DNS and secure it with DNSSEC. This is the reverse, okay? Because my interest is in trying to get adoption as quickly as possible. So I'm looking for inroads, backdoors, connections, whatever, interfaces, APIs into the large-scale large-scale applications like this. Okay, I got my key back. I don't know if you see it, but it's a little key that came back in email. And I'll paste that there. Fine. Okay. Okay, finish. Now I'm going to ask for a certificate, an SMI certificate. I know this is excruciatingly boring, but I just want to prove to you I'm not doing anything tricky here. Generate a private key. Okay, maybe if I spin the mouse around, I'll generate more random numbers here. This is the longest step in the process. So, I mean, there are some work being done, I know, in the open source side of this by VeriSign and my dear friend Eric Osterweil has done an awful lot of work in this area. And as I said, the barrier I see is that, you know, we need to get this out of the experimental stage and into the stage where it's attractive, maybe to some end users. Okay, there's algorithm. SHA-2, of course. Okay.
it's generated a key. I got the certificate now. Now I need to upload the certificate into the DNS in my DNSSEC server. So I'm going to view the certificate that they've given me. Yeah, I know this is way too small. I'm sorry. I don't know how else to make this kind of demo work. If you look at the subject line in here, I mean, it does say Bosch 2 at DNSSEC info. I want to copy that certificate to a file. So this is all Windows 10. Export the key, make it look like a PEM, you know, Base64 encoded. Fine, and I'm going to stick it somewhere. Drive E. Documents. Cert. Okay. Call it Bosch 2. Bosch 2. Okay. Export was successful. Cool. All right. So now I have a certificate. I need to upload the certificate. I'm going to upload the certificate into my DNS servers for, I run DNS servers for DNSSEC.info. Password with bar. Not anyone should be able to do this, so it's encrypted with your, controlled with your password. Bar foo2. Let's find the file. Bosch 2. Open. Come on. Fingers crossed. Okay. No way you could ever see that, but it actually returns back the S/MIME record. I don't think there's an IANA type assigned to it yet, so I'm just using type 53. Okay. All right. So we're getting there. We've gotten through the most difficult part. So I've gotten all the way through here. I've installed the certificate. When StartSSL provided the certificate back to me, that installed the certificate into Windows, and therefore Outlook has picked it up. I've generated the S/MIME, this S/MIME DNSSEC record, and it's already been published in the DNSSEC. Okay, so we need to go to some machine that's outside of this home realm that has no idea, that's not connected with this at all. So let's go to machine B. Voila, machine B. Right, and this is actually my ICANN machine here. Okay, I am going to. We have a strange VPN. I'm going to go out of the VPN, connect back to the VPN. Okay. So, all I'm going to do is try to send an email across. And you'll see it fail. So I'll say, okay, fine. Let's try to send an email. New email. Options encrypt. I want the email encrypted. I'm an evil guy. I'm hiding from the law. So, Bosch 2 at dnssec.info. Okay. Test. Can you read this? Okay. What I'm waiting for is to see sometimes, just I'm giving Outlook the benefit of the doubt here. Outlook will sometimes underline the email address once it knows something about that, or if it's able to determine something from its address book, to underline it. I'll try to send it. Many of you have probably seen this message before. It basically says the underlying, you know, certificates don't have any information on this guy. You want to send it unencrypted? No. Okay. So here comes the piece that solves all this. Okay. So then I say, I actually desperately was trying to find someone else to do this, could not find anyone to do it, found a friend of mine who is a Windows jock, and I got him to write a full LDAP to DNSSEC converter, or to DANE converter, full ASN1, DER1, all the ugly crap going on both sides. It's stuff I do too, so I know how to do this stuff. And he wrote it multi-threaded, multi-processor, all that stuff. Anyway. I don't care. I'm just an idiot. I just want to be able to send my email. So I click here to download this one little .exe file, lvdt.exe. Of course, there's a little message down there that says, you know, why would you want to do that? It's an executable file. I don't care. There's a SHA-256 hash in there as well. All right. Now I'm going to make you really angry. I just want to execute it. Are you sure? Yeah, I don't care. This is how most people work, right?
Hey, Rick.
Yeah.
Keep it on going.
Okay, so it says it's executing. It's down here in the lower right-hand corner. It is running, okay? So now I'm going to do the magic that has to be done in Outlook, account settings. This is the magic that you'll see. I mean, the magic is that piece of code that's converting things. But I'm gonna add another, just simply add another address book. Okay, the address book is this program that's running on the machine. Therefore, it is secure. It actually has its own validator written from scratch that walks up and down the chain to validate, but it's happening on the machine locally. That's the thing to notice here. All right, finished. Okay, close. It said restart, so I'll close that. Restart it. And, okay, restart. All right. Started. Okay. So now let's try the same thing. Okay. Now that this magical address book is in there. All right. I want to send an encrypted email to bosch2@dnssec.info. Test. Can you read this? Okay. Give it a second to see if it knows anything. I'm going to hit send. Well, there the demo failed. That was going to be the end of the demo. All right. That's embarrassing because that was the whole point of this thing.
All right.
But I'm going to explain to you that that's basically the if executed properly, what this does. This little piece here is what it does is it actually runs as just a little background process and converts these LDAP requests into DNSSEC. And I think it's an opportunity to convert many other things from LDAP to DANE and to DNSSEC and pull things out of there. And by doing that, bootstrapping kind of the adoption of DNSSEC. And so I will fix this at some point and you'll see the demo work.
Well, I want to thank you for doing a live demo in front of all of us this year, because that always takes a little bit of guts to do that. So thank you, Rick, for doing that.
And thanks for the liveness.
Yeah, and I do agree with you, too, that there are certainly, within a lot of the corporate enterprise space, S/MIME, this kind of mechanism is highly used. So it is extremely important. The work that you're doing, that Rick, the VeriSign Labs folks and the others are all, it's all good stuff to have in here. So we have a limited amount of time left, so I'm going to have to say, if you've got questions for Rick, let's find him after this. I want to turn it over to Paul Wouters, who is not going to talk about Windows, or if he did talk about Windows, we would be extremely surprised. You should sometimes, Paul, just to blow our minds, but you'd actually have to. Paul works for Red Hat, so that's why I'm saying
we intro really nicely with Windows.
Oh, okay. So Paul is going to come here, and I actually don't know what he's going to talk about, because I just have a thing that says DNSSEC/DANE demos. But I think so far we've been told he's going to tell us about TLSA records, and he's going to tell us about PGP and some other stuff. So here you are, Paul. So rock and roll.
So actually, I was not talking about TLSA records. I was going to talk about OpenPGP key records and SSHFP records. And I was hoping that my screen would appear.
It does. You got your screen up there. It says Fedora.
Oh, I see. Okay. I'm not very smart. Look, there it is. And I can even almost read it.
Wow. Thank you for giving us something very large for us to see.
Yeah. Unfortunately, my screen is a mirror right now. But, okay. So, I can't read that. Here is a very advanced Unix email client called Alpine. it actually works in like 10 by 5, or however small the screen is. And I asked Dan York to send me an email, which on my screen it actually displayed his name, but now it doesn't. So let's see if we can still see this. So this is demo@bothh.noets.ca, and he said his signature and deploy DNSSEC. So this email came in completely plain text. And I asked him to do this because otherwise he would get gray listed if I asked him in 5 minutes to send another email. So let's get out of this. So now we want to make this all automatically encrypted. So first thing I have to do is generate a key, which since it's GPG, of course, I forgot to probably, is this it? Yes, this is it. Okay, so we'll generate a key. I'll take a small key, it's faster. Sure, let's expire it in case it leaks out somewhere. Demo user. This is okay. Passphrase, what was it? What did you use? Fubar12? Okay, generating key. Not enough random bytes. Okay, let's shake my laptop. Okay. A trick for the advanced users. If you ever want entropy on a machine that doesn't have it.
There's also a demon that generates
it. There are also demons, that's right. But I just want find and slash user and seems to work really well. You just grab for nothing. Of course, did I back on the first one? I'm not sure. Wow, I'm fasting failer than Rick did. Oh, there we go. Okay, so we have a key. So let's see. GPG dash list key demo. There we go. And there should be a fingerprint somewhere off screen probably. Okay, let's see. --- fingerprint. So there we go. There is a fingerprint on the screen. So now we are ready to push this key. So I wrote a little package called Hashslinger that has a few tools in there, and one of the tools is called very originally PGP key. I can say --- create demo at buffh.nomads.ca, and of course the screen's a little small, but if you can see it there, you can see a little bit that says, you know, a little bit of a hash, and then ./openpgpkey.buffh.nomads.ca. So now the tricky bit. I'm going to select it and hope it'll work because I cannot see half of it. That is copy. Okay. And I will move to not that server. Where is my name server? This looks like my name server. Okay. That's my zone file. Buffh is actually not a separate zone, so it's all in here. So paste. There we go. I'm using OpenDNSX, so I'm not assigning my zone. And just in case it all didn't really reload, so there we go, reloaded. So now my zones, I'm chatting for like 30 seconds because now my zones are propagating this new data. The OpenPHP is going to spread to my other name servers. And now we go back to my client here, and I will start my email client again. I will delete Dan's old message. No, my email, and now we are going back to the mail server. And here you can already see. So on the mail server, I have a tool running called OpenPHP Key Milter. It's a little bit of Python that plugged into a mail server, and you can see that someone else tried to mail, and it gave the error, or it gave the message there: Miltberg message type passed unmodified. I'm not handling all MIME types yet, so now I'm asking Dan to send me another email.
But I don't have any PGP keys.
No, you don't need any PGPPs. So what's going to happen is Dan's going to send an email. It's going to go plain text to the MX server because he doesn't support any of this yet, but he will next time we're at the next ICANN meeting. Then once the email arrives at the MX server, which is actually not the end machine, it will accept the email, and we will see in the screen that it will detect that there is a PGP key, and it will automatically encrypt it and send the mail forward to the end machine. And then we'll see an encrypted email. And this will all happen really fast and automatic. And if not, I have a shortcut. Okay, so I'm actually also going to send an email from the server itself. And just in case the DNS record didn't work, I'm going to send it to another email address. And now you'll see, since they're received DNS executed open PGP key. So it found the PGP key for Paul at ballfaves.noise.ca. You can see the fingerprint there, and it sent an encrypted message to me. So this is how you can very easily support email encryption. Let's see if meanwhile I'll put on the oh, there we go. Here's an email from Dan, email 2. It seems to be suspiciously plain text. And there's another email here, which also seems suspiciously plain text. So again, Rick, this is how it works in demos. So I will not go to my own personal email folder because I really don't want to display it to everyone, but you can trust me that this line actually meant that it encrypted this message. So to summarize, the GNUPG actually now also have native support for generating these records. So even though I use my tool OpenPGPKeyCommand, native support is added to GNUPG, and the next version will actually have it. If you download the Git version, it will actually already have native support for it. OpenPGP can also then encrypt this automatically. So ideally, you would run this on your machine that you're sending the email from, so then it never actually leaves the network, never goes onto the network and plain text. So then, I will quickly switch to the other part of the demo that I was going to do, because I don't think I have much 5 minutes. Okay. So the other thing is, everybody uses SSH to SSH into remote service to the administration. Even though SSH is encrypted, if you connect to many servers, you don't always know what key that server has, or if the key changes because somebody else maintains the server, how do you know you're still connecting to the right server? So what you can do is, and I guess I'll try to make this a little smaller. So you can see here there's these SSHFP records in my zone. They're a little unreadable, but note that the bottom one, rogue.noads.ca, actually has a fingerprint of all zero. So that's actually a pretty bogus fingerprint that I put in there for testing. The other ones are real. So if you now connect to this server, you will see no message because I will kill all the. This is the file where it remembers all the previous answers you've given, so I've just wiped this entire file. So this account knows no SSH keys anymore. So if I do an SSH again, by default, this is not enabled. This is a 4-year battle of me trying to enable this lookup by default. And I cannot get the SSH maintainer in RHEL and Fedora to enable this until upstream does. So if anybody has experiences in getting this verify host key DNS option set in upstream SS OpenSSH will be really nice.
Hey Paul, I have like a 6-year-old trouble ticket on that very topic. They won't do it.
Okay, that's great. If you give me the ticket number, that would actually be really useful for me to override upstream.
Okay.
So surprisingly, I see it actually is enabled on this machine. So the next check to see if I'm using a secure resolver if something happened. Yeah, that's pretty secure. Okay, so I'll jump out of that machine just to do this on another machine. There we go, that's better. Interesting. Okay, so let's see what happened here. Wow. Okay, so I guess we open another ticket. because what happened? So ISSH, it told me, warning, remote host key has changed in a big banner. Somebody could be eavesdropping on your connection right now. And then it said, or maybe someone just changed the host key, like the administrator. It gives me the fingerprint of the ECDSA key. Then tells me nothing. And I think I know why. Oh, there it is. Update the SSHFP RR and DNS. So actually, this was a mismatch of the SSHFP record. So it should have actually not connected. But apparently, it connected anyway because I managed to log in. So that's an interesting bug, and it's not even my software. okay, so I'm really curious what happens to when you go to rogue, because I'm pretty sure when you go to rogue, but no, it's here, it wouldn't let me in. That's better. So now we're actually getting a question. Except now it doesn't find its record in DNS. Okay. This is an even better demo.
This shows the security aspect working.
Not really, because I'm losing my DNSSEC records. So,
details.
Maybe this all worked before. Anyway, so there is a slide deck that shows the proper working examples that have been broadcast during this demo too. So you can grab those from the website and actually see it working in a little bit better action than I showed here. Which, of course, I made with the exact same laptop 2 days ago. So. What a surprise.
Oh, thank you, Paul, for doing a live demo here. Let's just give Paul a round of thanks on that one. Any questions for Paul? Go ahead.
Don't want to monopolize the microphone, but anyway. Max Frey, Global Village. We actually discussed using SSHFP records for our network, but discovered that the client support for that is not too great at the moment. So apart from Linux SSH, we could not find many, and we have a lot of administrators who are using actually Windows to connect to the Linux machines. PuTTY does not seem to support it. Is there any support on the road for multi-platform support of SSHFP?
Not that I'm aware. I thought PuTTY was going to do something with DNSSEC, but I guess they haven't done that yet.
Okay, and you personally don't know of any developments in that area?
No.
Or alternative SSH clients for Mac and Windows?
No, as far as I don't know that many SSH clients actually. I know OpenSSH and PuTTY, which are like the 99% of the market, and I think there are some FTP clients that support SFTP, but not really SSH. So I'm not aware of any other popular clients out there that actually do SSH.
Okay, so thanks.
The one thing I wanted to point out as a known bug in the SSH client was that it actually didn't look at the DNSSEC status. And in fact, when you're using an insecure name server, it actually also just told you, oh, this SSHFP fingerprint is awesome. You should trust it. So that's three bugs now that you should file.
All right. Well, good that we're getting some bugs filed here. All right. Well, thank you, Paul and Rick and Wes and Sarah. So please join me in a round of applause for the folks who are here. I will also point out that if you've got an idea, why don't, as Christian, if you want to come up and if our panelists want to change out, or do you want to just present from there?
Yeah.
Okay, you can just be there. Well, then the panelists, you guys can sit there if you want to.
if you've got an idea like this, if you want to do something around this, we will be looking soon for proposals for the next session in Marrakesh at the next ICANN meeting. So if you've got an idea, you too could come up here and do that. As Paul noted, he did provide a set of slides that have these on there, and you can go to the main page here for this session on the ICANN website, and we have all of the different presentations that were given today. The slides for them are all there. So if you missed something earlier, if you want to see something that's there, you can go and get the slide decks from there. We also, on that same page, we'll have the Adobe Meeting Room recording of all of this. So you'll have the audio and the slides integrated so you can listen and hear about that. And then, as you've seen, I'm also streaming it through YouTube, so you'll be able to have a recording there as well. So let me get into our last presentation. Oh no, Rick wants to say something?
Just one thing, because I feel like I screwed that up pretty bad. I'll put a link to a video file, a movie file, for a demo that does work, for those that would care for some reason.
All right, well, Rick, I think it's great that you tried it too. I mean, we've had, like this, right? You get the live demo gods interfering always as far as what happens in that regard. But it's great, we keep trying these, we keep doing them. Some of them work, some of them don't, it's all good. And at least it shows we have real running code and pieces like this. So I want to reintroduce Christian, who was talking to us earlier today about what's happening in NL. And he wants to now talk a bit about what can we do to get more ISPs doing validation. So over to you, Christian.
That's right, thank you, Dan. So my presentation is entitled Simulating DNSSEC Validation at .NL, and it's not only focused on getting ISPs to do some work. As I pointed out this morning, that's kind of difficult. So this work was actually done by the three guys that are on that page there, on the slide there, Marco, Yelta, and Martin, and they're my team. So first, a brief introduction. SIDN, the registry for the Netherlands, and SIDN Labs is the R&D team of SIDN. So we currently have 5.6 million domain names in our registry, and we have roughly 2.4 million of those are signed with DNSSEC. We work with around 1,500 registrars, which are most of them are in the Netherlands, but they're also in the States and also in Germany, for example. And in addition to being the registry for .NL, we're also the registry service provider for .Amsterdam, which is the Netherlands capital. And we're also the RSP for .AW, which is the country code for Aruba. And as I discussed already this morning, our major challenge at this point is how to get DNSSEC validation going, because signing, of course, is very important, but the other side of the coin is validation. And without validation, DNSSEC is of no use. So what I'm going to talk about here is basically four different initiatives that we took to get this thing going. Next slide. Oops, that's one too far. Thank you. So the first thing that we did recently is we set up a DNSSEC resolver service, which are basically two machines with running unbound. That we set up in our infrastructure, thus basically making DNSSEC validation a service that's being offered by the registry rather than by ISPs. And we did this because we noticed that we knew that ISPs weren't doing anything themselves, and we didn't want to sit on our hands. So that's why we decided to take the initiative ourselves and set up these two machines. In addition, it will also enable us to get to more experience in running these resolvers, which we haven't done really before. At least we did it on our own office network, of course, but not for external clients. So we're currently carrying out a pilot with a high school, which has around 1,000 students in there. You can see the traffic on the right in the figure. And unlike Google Public DNS and VeriSign Public DNS, for instance, we opted for a whitelisted service, which means that it's not an open resolver, but you only need to sign up with SIDN, and then we'll give you access to the machines. The reason for doing that is that we first ran an open resolver on our lab network, which was spotted as an open resolver within a couple of hours, and it also attracted a lot of abuse traffic. So we decided to take this model instead of the open resolver model. Next slide, please. So the second initiative is basically validation on a small device. We call this, the working title of that device is a Valley Box, as you can see up there. It's a GLINET device, which is a very small box that you can hook into your home network. So this is more for the end users rather than for organizations. The box runs on OpenWRT, the operating system, which we basically modified the firmware so that it now acts as a validating resolver. We configured the device such that if you run into a domain name that generates a validation error, you get a warning page as a user, and you can either go through, so to decide to go through to the untrusted page anyway, or you can put in a negative trust anchor, thereby saying to the box that not to resolve for this domain name anymore. So we currently have around 20 of these devices configured, and we're handing them out at SIDN to our staff so that they can use them at home. And we're kind of hoping that this will take off on the larger scale so that folks will also be able to use it, let's say, more broadly. The one thing I forgot to mention is that this works with, you can't really see it because the version that we're doing right now has an antenna on it, so it actually uses Wi-Fi. So what you get when you plug this one into your home network, it will give you an additional SSID, and you need to then connect to that SSID to make use of the validating resolver. Next slide, please. This is very difficult to read in the back, I think, but this is a tool that we also briefly talked about this morning. It's basically to scan the entire .NL zone for validation errors proactively. About a year and a half ago, we developed a tool that would receive validation errors from, let's say, two or three smaller ISPs that had experimental DNSSEC resolvers in their infrastructure. So we would take those validation errors and pass them on to our registrar so that they could fix the error. And what we did a couple months ago is that we extended that software so that the validation monitor, as we call it, now scans the entire zone proactively every 24 hours, and picks up the validation errors and sends them as usual through to the registrar. So that's something you can see on the figure on the right over there. So the enormous spike. The one other thing that we do is during the previous version of the validation monitor, we also learned what typical third level domain names were, and so we're also using those to check validation errors at the third level. And that's also why we're seeing a sudden spike in this figure on the right. So there's a purple line almost all the way on the right, which is when we turned on the DNSSEC validation error, the new one. And as you can see, it resulted in many more validation errors, mostly because of these third level domains. But fortunately, you can already see the line going back down again. Okay. So just to give you, just to give you an indication of the numbers we're talking about here, all the way on the right, so with the new validation monitor turned on, we get about around 6,000 validation errors in a month. That's per day, I'm sorry. That's 6,000 per day, which is around 25% of the total number of DNSSEC signed domain names. And previously, before we actually turned on this new version, it was 205 validation errors, which was 0.01%. But the advantage of this system is that it's much more elaborate and it scans the entire zone, enabling registrars to discover validation errors much more quickly than previously. Okay, next slide, please. And the fourth initiative that we worked on is something that we call the Registrar's Scorecard. So this is a broader initiative for our registrars so that they can get more insight into their domain name portfolio. For instance, in terms of the actual use of the domain names they have registered with us, in terms of data quality, in terms of the level of churn, and that sort of thing. And we provide the registrars with a discount if they perform well here. Part of this registrar scorecard is the number of DNSSEC validation errors. So we previously would give a discount to our registrars whenever they would sign a domain name, but we now changed that a little bit, and we're now saying, okay, if it's signed, that's great, but you only get the discount if it also validates correctly. And in addition, you cannot really see it on the slide, but we provide the registrar with a couple statistics on the average number of validation errors and if that registrar performs below or above that threshold. So they can also compare themselves against the other registrars. And this tool actually makes use of the software that of the validation monitor that I discussed on the previous slide. Next slide, please. So to sum up, I think that at least what we did in the Netherlands at .nl, we basically took the lead in trying to stimulate validation ourselves, because we know that, well, ISPs are basically not doing that. And we took a multi-track approach. We offered validation functionality both as a service on the resolver machines and as well as through these tiny iNet devices. We helped to further reduce validation errors through the DNSSEC validation monitor, but also through this registrar scorecard on the previous slide. And we not only go, let's say, what I call horizontal, trying to convince ISPs to turn on DNSSEC validation, but we also, for instance, in schools and perhaps even local governments in the future, to also get them to validate DNSSEC signatures. So that's what I talked about here. And in addition, we spend a lot of effort on things like sponsoring software. So we sponsor NLNet Labs, for instance, which are the guys behind Unbound. We sponsored PowerDNS. We previously ran a large-scale pilot with several universities, to turn on validation on their networks. We're involved with governments to get DNSSEC signing and validation as part of their procurement procedures, and we basically promote the use of DNSSEC a lot. So one initiative that's maybe interesting is internet.nl, which enables every end user to check if he's using DNSSEC or if his ISP is using DNSSEC or not through a web page. And we're also providing DNSSEC statistics on our own lab on the site of SIDN Labs, which is stats.sidnlabs.nl. So that's the work that we're doing at .nl to get things going. But of course, the biggest jump ahead would be that ISPs start to do validation. Next slide, please. Oh, that was my last slide. So please, I encourage you to visit stats.sidnlabs.nl, which contains all kinds of statistics on the .nl zone, including statistics on DNSSEC requests that we process on our name servers. You can go back 18 months in time, so to speak, because we save all that data on one of our Hadoop platforms. And so hopefully that's interesting for you guys to check out. Thank you.
You also have provided us very nice little coasters, if anybody wants a coaster, that says, secure the internet, do the DNSSEC check.
Yep.
So if anybody wants coasters, they're floating around over here. Somebody has roamed around and done this, and I think Christian would probably prefer not to take them back home with him. So
thanks, Dan.
Go ahead and pick them up and do that. There you go. There's some more along here. Over there. Get them. So questions for Christian. comments, jokes, whatever.
Christian, very impressive. Thank you. Have you guys, if you are very policy-oriented, started thinking about suspending domains that stay at the NSSEC invalidatable for a long time?
Be sure to state your name.
I'm all over.
That's a good point. We haven't done that yet. But we might need to be more strict there, perhaps. Yeah.
Other questions, comments? What else are people doing to get people doing validation in their area?
Jacques Plateau, Dottier. So one thing we do in Canada is, we have an ISP summit where all the Canadian telcos meet on a annual basis. And I've been doing stats from APNIC. I've been showing the result of Canada being maybe 1% validation. And now we're up to 9 and 10. And one of the main reasons in the recent bump is one large ISP upgraded their recursive name servers, and by default, the NSSEC is enabled validation. So that was it. They didn't even know they did the NSSEC until I reported the status.
I think we've seen that before. We've seen it in the Netherlands with T-Mobile, but at some point they turned it back off. And I think we also saw it in Buenos Aires when I think a person from Chile noticed or presented on their work on DNSSEC and said that one of the largest ISPs in Chile had turned on DNSSEC validation. So perhaps it just takes a smart system administrator or network engineer to get things done.
Or software vendors who just turn it on by default and just, you know, maybe don't necessarily make that a highlight of their next change in announcements.
Yeah, that might even be better.
Yep.
Howard Ensing, DK. So I think a year or two ago, we tried to get the three largest ISPs together, and two of them said, we're not even interested in sending anyone to Copenhagen to talk to you. And the third one says, well, it's already on a roadmap. I'm going to do it in a couple of months. So the largest ISP in Denmark is validating DNSSEC right now. I have no idea about their internal discussions of how that happened, but I do think it were a couple of geeks that got that through. But the one thing I would suggest is...
Beer.
Is beer, yeah.
Yes, I think getting the ISPs to talk to each other, especially having an ISP that does validation, talk to the ISPs that do not, and tell them how many more support calls they get, that would be very good, because I think most ISPs are very hesitant to turn on DNSSEC validation where they don't see an incentive of getting more revenue, but do see the fear of getting more support calls, which are expensive. So having them talk to each other and make sure that, and for us, making sure that most domains do validate and they don't get support calls, that would be very good.
How about our Czech friends sitting across the table from me? What have you guys done to get your ISPs validating as much as they have? Or did you all just meet in a bar and decide that this was how to do it?
Yeah, basically, and we sort of cooperating with the National Exchange Point, so, you know, they have regular meetings, so on those meetings we were sponsoring some drinks, and while we're drinking, we are telling them that the DNSSEC is a great thing.
That's an actually interesting tie-in, though, to the IXP side of things. So you're right, because you do have the ISPs meeting at the IXP, and so that is an interesting way to have some folks there. Good idea. Other comments? What else have people done out here? Robert is looking for a microphone.
To work? Yeah. I haven't done anything because I'm not that part of the spectrum right now, but I was thinking a registry could do some kind of certification and give a certain level of B+ or B- A+ whatever to an ISP, and they can brag about that. I don't know if they would use that for anything, but usually something coming from the TLD administrator might actually carry some weight with the geeks.
In the Netherlands, we do have that implicitly through this internet.nl site where end users can check if their ISP validates or not, but perhaps we need to be more transparent in that way and also list the ISPs on the site somewhere that do this or not. A bit more naming and shaming.
Twitter, Facebook.
that kind of thing. Yeah, there have been different discussions over time that we should have some kind of, you know, name and shame site around, you know, encouraging, listing the ISPs that do or don't. I just, nobody's yet come up and said, yeah, we're willing to either do that, fund that, maintain it, whatever else, because the challenge with any of those sites, such as that list of registrars that support DNSSEC, right, Rick? You and I both have challenges maintaining our separate lists around that.
Yeah.
So it's easy to create that stuff, harder to maintain, so we've got to go on that. Okay, any other comments for Christian? I really like your different ideas that you, I mean, the different tracks you're doing. I'll be curious to see, I mean, I like, you know, you provided a DNSSEC validation service right out there, and then the little appliance things. You know, and then the monitoring service, I think all of those are great ideas. So it'll be interesting to see what kind of uptake you get on those. When are you putting little boxes out?
Well, initially we're, let's say, handing them out to our staff so that they can try them at home, because we recently configured that those devices, so we need to simply try them first and then see if there's any external, if people outside of the company would like them.
So are they replacing like the home Wi-Fi router or whatever that somebody would have?
No, it's in addition to, because it basically creates an additional SSID with, let's say, which has the validating resolver on it, because it's a wireless LAN access point, that thing. So you would need to connect in your home. You would need to connect to that particular SSID.
Oh, interesting. Yeah. And I know the CZ Nick folks have your turret project, which is getting CPE devices out to people, which do the DNSSEC validation right there. We've had some other good success with DNS Mask now supporting DNSSEC validation, so that will slowly percolate out to the CPE devices to do something around that. Russ, yes?
One of the things I want to mention is that Comcast, who really went whole hog into this, the person that really led the charge there was Jason Livingood, and a couple of conversations that I've had with him over time. It really, in terms of a major provider, I mean, they do sign zones as well as all their validation stuff, but essentially Jason wrapped the DNSSEC part into a larger scale security package. And so if there are ISPs that are focusing on, if you will, providing a higher level of security than just sort of the generic ISP that people get, they might be a good set of people to approach to say, okay, you say you're higher security, here's something else that you ought to look at incorporating as part of your security-ness.
I spoke with Paul in Buenos Aires, and I asked him, okay, why are you guys so successful in validating DNSSEC? And his opinion was that the senior management of Comcast was convinced that this was something useful, and they also understood what DNSSEC was about. So that kind of helped a lot.
Well, yes, Jason Livingood is, what are the senior VPs, or I'm not sure what
his
title is.
He's about three levels up from Paul, and actually he was the one that sold it. Paul came after it went in. But I mean, this has been what Jason has described sort of in the global picture, is when he sold it and to the people, basically he convinced them, because they were, as a corporation, trying to be the most secure home ISP provider around, and they offered several other security things. And so he was able to say, and you must include DNSSEC as part of it, because it's a critical part of the overall security picture.
Jacques?
So I guess we need to write some sort of document, DNSSEC for dummies? No, DNSSEC for execs.
Yes, and we've had that conversation.
For ISP execs.
We need to have that for execs. And we've also, in fairness, I've talked to Jason too about how he can network within some of his peers, you know, to help do that too. So, yeah. Robert, did you have something? Okay.
And there's just one last thing. I think there's still some stigma from many years ago when somebody made a presentation that recursive server would need way more CPU power, way more memory, way more bandwidth to process to do DNSSEC validation. And that's not true. So we need to dispel that myth somehow.
So who wants to make that presentation in Marrakesh? Anybody want to work on a presentation like that?
Hopefully we can get the results from Roland's student that will help in that space, and perhaps he'd be able to participate at the next meeting or a following meeting.
So, all right, that sounds good, but also maybe I'll throw that out as a topic for the community. If there are anybody, if that is one thing that could we could work on, it would be good to find anybody who could do a little bit of research into what does it take to go and do that. All right, well, thank you, Christian, for bringing this to the group here. So the final little bit is the Russ and Dan show talking a bit about what thanking people and going on from there. So Julie is going to bring up our slides. And I will just start by thanking once again, I'm trying to remember if I have this in the slide as we look at this. Can we go to the next slide? Oh, no, okay, back up for a second. So before we leave, I just want to say a big thank you again to the five sponsors who brought this here. Sarah, I know I can see you right here, Jacques, and SIDN, we've got Christian. I don't know if we have anybody from .ST here, but Anne-Marie is always around and has been a great person with us here. Aphilius, Jim Galvin, if you see him anytime tomorrow, thank him, because it's through his support and others that we've been able to do this. And Dine, if you saw them at, how many of you went to their party last night? Okay, a number of folks, okay. Well.
Also, Dine and Aphilius both have booths, so folks can stop by down there and thank them for lunch.
Yes, thank them for helping provide this lunch. And again, I'll put a plug in if anybody is interested. It's a very inexpensive sponsorship, but it helps keep us all happy over the scope of 2016. We've got one spot open. Anyway, let's go on. So we want to wrap this up by saying, how can you help? Now that you've been here, go ahead, the next slide. One of the things we like to say is that for TLD operators, we would encourage any of you who are TLD operators to sign your TLD, accept your DS records, work with the registrars, and also help with statistics. One of the things, you know, we've been trying to do is to gather good statistics around what are the, what's the range of validation? You know, Jeff Houston has the APNIC stats that he uses, that we use now as to show the overall state of validation. But we're looking for more ways to do it, and we're looking for more, you know, more mechanisms. So to the degree that anybody can help plug in with this, it would be excellent. If we go on to the next slide, you want to do that one, Russ?
Sure. Yeah, for you, just a broad generic, any zone operator, anybody that operates an authoritative server ought to look at signing your zones, because especially on the zone signing site, that's really straightforward now. There's lots of tools, lots of automation as part of the whole key change process and update process. And most of the software has it where you just have to watch to make sure there's not a software error. So signing the zones is something really good, really, really interesting first step. And a lot of you have taken that first step. That's wonderful. Working with your registrars to generate support, because if you're a registry that's signing, that's what we spent a lot of time talking about today. There's been this challenge in the registrar space, but as registry operators, working with your registrars, and like I mentioned earlier in the interchange, that one of the biggest success stories we have was Comcast, and they sold it as a package. And so if you have some registrars that are pushing their high security capability, go to them and encourage them to sign it. And again, work with statistics and work, use the DNSSEC tools that are out there in your day-to-day work so that you can have real live end user experience in your own environment.
Next slide. For network service providers, ISPs, we really encourage, as we've just talked about, encouraging ISPs, if you know of your ISP, to deploy validation, get this out there, get this working then. And if you are not directly with an ISP, we do ask people to go and ask their ISPs, because we have so many network service providers who come to us and say, well, nobody ever asks me for DNSSEC. So file, you know, raise the support ticket, send an email in and say, will you support DNSSEC validation? As Robert said over there, contact them on Twitter. Tweet to them and say, hey, when are you guys going to give us DNSSEC validation? Those things actually do matter and start to make it the sense inside that somebody says, oh, hey, maybe we should investigate this. So one big thing you can do to help move that forward is just to raise those kind of issues. We also ask service providers, ISPs, to look at, you know, DANE. We've talked about this here, and encouraging the use of DANE is something that, again, can be done to help raise the awareness around this. Next slide, please. So, websites, we just encourage anybody with a website, sign your zones, sign your domains, you know, and in this case, contact your DNS hosting operator, which may or may not be your registrar, and see if they'll do it for you, or if they are the ones doing your DNS for you. If you operate your own DNS, then obviously you can go and do that there, and contact your registrars, because sometimes they don't support it, and we've heard yet from registrars in this meeting and other places, yeah, but nobody ever asked me for DNSSEC. So ask for DNSSEC. It will help those registrars and certain registrar advocates. We could tell and we could say, well, hey, they have, somebody has asked for it. So go ahead and do that. And then also ask anybody in your environment, your network, to get the validation out there.
One other thing that we probably need to add to this slide then is instead of just websites, it's also SMTP and email providers, because there's a big and emerging area and a lot of capability, and there may in fact be a number of providers out there that have the capability, especially with PostFix shipping with it by default. It's not turned on, but it's there, and it's a very easy configuration to set up. And EMXI, I think, also. But
anyway. Yeah, there's email companies in Germany who are advertising that they support DNSSEC and DANE, which is kind of cool. Good stuff. We'll see more of that. All right, next slide. Yeah, use DNSSEC. Share your lessons learned. Participate in this community and in the workshops. There's a number of mailing lists that a good number of us subscribe to. There are some, there's some LinkedIn groups, there's some other different places that a number of us are connected to in some way, and please, you can go and join that. I think on the next page, we have some of the links that are out there. DNSSEC-deployment.org is a site that we still have out there, and it's also a site that, if you're interested, we can post a content and information to, we being myself, in this case, as far as the one who's maintaining that. And so if you've got ideas or things you'd like to write about with regard to DNSSEC, we're always looking to post more information and content. The Deploy 360 program, oh, Julie, we never fixed that from last time. It's internetsociety.org/deploy360. We have to, yeah, I know, we didn't, it was my failure. I didn't fix that. So there is no Internet Society TLD. It's internetsociety.org. Yeah, I know. No, but anyway, /deploy360. We have a number of resources out there. And also, we're looking for people to help write some more resources and things to help explain more. The tutorials and things like DNSSEC for executives and things like that. We, part of our mission with deploy360 is to help make this more easy to understand. So we're looking to do that. If anybody would like to contribute some time and write some of those types of documents, or if you've written one that's really good that you think we should help spread the word about, we are always glad to do that and help spread the word and do that. And finally, dnssec-tools.org, which you heard Wes talk about earlier when he was here, and Russ is involved with that as well, has a set of software that is always there and growing in terms of what it's about. And I think that is all. So thank you very much for participating.
One more quick comment, and that is we have a number of people that are maybe first-time attenders here or haven't been here very often. I think everybody's heard that there's a lot of interchange. There's a very great deal of willingness to help throughout this community. So if any of you need help with anything related to DNSSEC, just start finding people, asking questions, going to the website, joining mail lists, and there's an extremely high likelihood you're going to get a fairly fast response from some of the most knowledgeable people in the field, because the folks involved in this are very passionate about making it happen, and they're willing to help pretty much anybody get going. So thanks for joining us, and please continue to work this way and ask questions if you have.
And if you're from the Ecuador CCTLD, Roy Ahrens really wants to talk to you. Okay, he wants that DNSSEC to be signed. All right, well, with that, I want to say thank you to Julie and Kathy again for all of their work to make this happen. The program committee could not do it without these two over there who maintain us, get us keep going and all of that. So thank you, Julie and Kathy. With
thanks,
that,
thanks everyone. I just want to say too, I think we equally need to thank Dan and Russ. So also keep this thing running really well.
Thank you, Julie. And with that, we will see you all in Marrakesh. Thank you.